Record the video. Okay. So in this slide, we have to just to see the continuation of chapter number 21, Coulomb's law. So in this slide, we are going to study the formula for Coulomb's law. Coulomb is the name of the scientist. What he did? He predicted the formula for, he find the formula for electrostatic force of repulsion and the electrostatic force of attraction. So what he did, he find the force between two charges. So what he did, if you want to find the force, how many charges you need, you must need two charges. And you have to take the magnitude of the charges. So if you take positive and positive charge, what will happen? It will repel. If you take negative and negative, it will repel. If you take positive and negative, it will attract. Clear? So now, what is the matter? We are going to find the force of attraction or force of repulsion. So if you want to calculate this electrostatic force, what you have to do, you must need two charges. That means the product of two charges. Product of two charges mean Q1 and Q2. Clear, my dear?
Clear, yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay. Q1 and Q2. Now, the second important thing, the distance between the two charges. For example, if you see the picture, I have two positive charge. Am I right? And you can see these two charges are separate with a distance R. My dear, I'm going to ask you a question. If the distance is small, what should be your force? If the distance will be greater, what should be your force? Because logically you can think, if the distance is small, what will happen to the force?
It will be more.
More. If the distance will be greater?
It will be less.
Decrease. Your force will be getting weaker. So your force is inverse relation with the square of the distance between the two charges. So here R is not a radius, R is the distance. Generally, if you ask the question about this Coulomb's law, you know what the students they will do? They will write the formula, everything perfectly. But when they are about to explain the word, explain the letter R, they will say it's a radius. It is not a radius. It is the distance between the two charges. So if you see the first relation, the force entirely depend on the product of magnitude of the two charges. And your force has the inverse relations between the square of the distance between these two. Now, if I want to club these two in one equation, how I can write? F has the direct relation with the magnitude of two charges, and it has the inverse relation with the square of the distance between the two charges. Clear? Now, I want to avoid this proportionality symbol, so I have to introduce one constant, and that constant is called as Coulomb constant K. It has the value of 8.99, 10 to the power of 9, Newton meter square per Coulomb square. So, in place, if you want to avoid this proportionality symbol, I have to introduce the constant K, and here K is a Coulomb constant. So, remaining term, magnitude of the first charge, magnitude of the second charge divided by the square of the distance between the two charges. So this is the formula for the Coulomb's law. And here we are going to solve 5 questions, and all these 5 questions are related with this formula. Clear? Understand, my dear?
Clear, doctor. The first formula, should we keep it?
My dear, generally we will give the value of this 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. Here, epsilon naught is the constant value. When you multiply this value with 4 pi, you will get this term. So generally, in exam time, if you ask any question from this chapter, we will give the value of K. So better just recall the formula like this. Clear?
Clear.
But what is the K? Maybe sometimes we may ask the question in one more question. What is K? Your K is exactly equal to?
1 over 4 pi.
So my dear, in theory question, sometimes we may ask these things. So your K has the value of 8.99, 10 to the power of 9. How we got? When you take this epsilon naught value, when you substitute here, you will get this 8.99. So generally in the problem, if you are about to solve the questions from this chapter, the K value will be given. So you can write the formula like this. But what is this K? This K is exactly equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. Clear?
What you mean by absolute naught?
epsilon naught is a constant. When you are just using the concept of charges, we have to multiply this permittivity constant. It's another constant.
Another constant. Okay.
Clear.
Clear. Q1 and Q2, it should absolutely, right?
Is an absolute value. Suppose if you take two charges as negative, no issue. Just take the magnitude.
Okay.
Clear. My dear, listen carefully. All constants value will be given in your paper. So don't worry about the constant. Understand?
Yes, doctor.
Okay. Now, in this slide, we are going to study the formula for the current. Because we have one formula, which is Ohm's law. V is equal to I multiplied by R. V is the voltage, I is the current, R is the resistance. And from this formula, you can easily calculate the current formula by using the voltage and the resistance. But in this chapter, what we are going to do, we are going to study the another formula for the current. For example, if you see this picture, if you connected this metallic wire, conducting wire with the battery, what will happen? The current will be flowing through this, because the electric current is nothing but the flow of charges. So you can write the formula current, electric current I, which is equal to how much of charges passing per time. So current I, which is equal to electric charge Q divided by T. So how much of time will be required to move the charges from one point to another point. So you have two formulas for the current. So please read the question. What is given in the question? Based on that, choose the formula. Generally, we will study this formula in chapter number 26, not in this chapter. Clear? Understood?
Understand. Doctor, could you please upload this formula, IQ over T?
IQ over T, yeah. It's there.
Where?
Here.
I don't see it. Ah, okay.
It is small amount of current over small amount of time. In general, you can write charge over time. Okay.
Okay.
Now, you can apply the superposition principle for number of charges. For example, you can see the picture, my dear. I'm going to place three charges. So charge one, charge two, charge three. Okay. So this is my Q1. This is my Q2. This is my Q3, for example. What is the distance between Q1 and Q2? I can take R12. Am I right?
Yes, doctor.
Yes, doctor.
Yes.
What is the distance between charge 1 and 3? R13. What is the distance between charge 2 and 3? R23. Now, you know the Coulomb's law. Apply the Coulomb's law for this R12. Apply the Coulomb's law for this Q1 and Q3. And apply the formula for charge 2 and 3. Now you know the formula. Am I right, my dear? Could you please apply the formula? F12. That means electrostatic force between the charge 2, 1 and 2 is K, magnitude of Q1, magnitude of Q2. The distance between these two charges is R12 square. Am I right?
Yes.
Likewise, for the second charge, F1 and 3. So K, Q1, Q3 divided by R13. Am I right? Likewise, charge 2 and 3, the force between the charge 2 and 3 is nothing but K, Q2, Q3 over R23 square. Now, what is the resultant force, my dear? My resultant force F, which is equal to F12 plus F13 plus F23. Am I right? Am I right or not?
Yes, you're right.
So likewise, you can just find this. So if you have number of charges, if you have n number of charges, how you can write? You can just use the formula. So if you want to apply the superposition principle, you have to take any two charges. That information is given in this box. You can just read here. The net electrostatic force exerted by the group of charge is equal to the vector sum. You can see vector sum means you have to add each and every force between two charges. And you have to find the resultant force. Clear? Clear, my dear?
Yes, of course, doctor.
Okay. Now the last, the most important, because in this chapter we are going to study only two formula. We already finished this Coulomb's law. Now our second important formula here is charge quantization. For example, I have one big charge. I am going to break this charge into many individual pieces. So when I just broke, for example, I have one big charge. I just broke the charge into three pieces. Now each and every pieces carries the value of the charge. Am I right? Each and every pieces have some value. Am I right?
Yes, doctor.
My dear, here when you broke any charges, the charge will never have the value of half value, quarter value, 3/4. So your charge value is exactly the value of the charge. So each and every pieces, suppose if I broke the charges into three pieces, means each and every pieces carries the value of 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. And we have to say that each pieces is nothing but the elementary charge. So here, when you broke any charges into any number of pieces, and each pieces carries the value of 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. So you should not say, I have half charges, I have quarter charges. It is not possible. It's a rounded value. So if you take one pieces, means that pieces carries the value of 1.6. And that, what is that? It is nothing but the elementary charge. Clear? So if you want to find the net charges, what you have to do, you have to say n multiplied by the charge. For example, if I have five pieces, I have one charge, I broke into five pieces. So what you have to do, we have to say 5 multiplied by 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19. So which will give the information about the net charge. So our second formula in this chapter is net charge Q, which is equal to n multiplied by the elementary charge. Clear? Clear, my dear?
Can you repeat, doctor, please?
For example, my dear, you have one charge, okay? Understand? You break the charge into five pieces. Now, how many pieces you have? You have five pieces, small five pieces in your hand. Am I right?
Yes.
So what should be the value of one piece? What should be the value of one piece?
1.6.
So each piece has the value of 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19. So if you want to calculate the net charge, you have to use this rule. My net charge Q, which is equal to number of pieces multiplied by the elementary charge, which is nothing but 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. Clear?
Yes, doctor, yes.
Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Now we are going to conclude this session with this conservation of charge. My dear, we already know the formula, know the definition for conservation of energy. Am I right? What is the definition for conservation of energy? Energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but you can transfer the energy from one form to another form. Am I right?
Yes, doctor.
Yes.
So you can apply the same concept for the charge. Your charge is conserved. So you cannot be able to create any charge. You cannot be able to destroy any charge, but you can move the charge from one body to another body. So your total number of charges is conserved. The charges will never lose. So if you just finally, if you just see the total number of the charge, it will be exactly the same value. Clear? Now I will just give you one example. You can see this picture. My dear, listen carefully. Here, how many objects I am going to take? I am going to take three objects. What are they? First, I am going to take the amber crystal. Second, I am going to take the fur material. And third, I am going to take the feather. So these are all the three material I am going to take. Clear? What are they? Amber crystal, fur material, and the feather, bird feather. Now you can see here, I told you already, if you take any material, initially that material is the neutral object. What is the meaning for neutral object? What is the meaning for neutral object?
The same number of electron and proton.
It will have the same number of positive charge, same number of negative charge. For example, you can see the fur material. In this fur material, how many neutrals, how many electrons, how many protons I have? How many positive and how many negatives are here?
The same, four.
Same, so four. And if you just see the amber crystal, I have three positive charge, three negative charge. If you take a bird further, I have one positive charge, one negative charge. So now, all these three materials are neutrally object. That means before. Now, what I am going to do, I am going to take this amber crystal, I am going to rub with this material. So what will happen? Generally, the fur material, it's like a hair-like structure, am I right? So when you take this glass, the amber crystal, when you rub on this fur material, what will happen? Generally, the fur material will lose its electron. So now you can see, after you rub this crystal with this fur, what happened? All the electrons from this fur is transferred to the crystal. Am I right? Am I right or not?
Yes, you are right.
Now you can see your amber crystal is a negatively charged object. Because why? My negative charge number is more here. Now what I am going to do, when I take this amber crystal, when I just put near to this feather, what will happen? Polarization takes place. We already studied the concept of polarization. Do you remember that? What is the meaning for polarization? Charge division. So when you take this amber crystal, when you bring close to this feather, what will happen? Positive side will be settle one side and negative will be going to the other side. And now when you place the amber near to this feather, what will happen? The feather will attract it with this amber crystal like this. Clear? So when you place this, after you rub this crystal with this fur, my crystal becomes negatively charged particle. When I put this negatively charged particle near to the neutral object, what will happen? The neutral object, this feather will attracted, it will be attached with this amber crystal because of the polarization concept. Clear? Clear?
Clear, yes. Clear, yes.
Okay, now the concept is conservation of charge. Now you can see how many positive, how many negatives we have here. We have four positive and four negative. Am I right? So totally I have eight. So that means a four positive, four negative. Here I have three positive, three negative. Here I have one positive, one negative. Could you please count at all this? Could you please count at all this? That means a four negative plus three, seven. So eight positive and eight negative we have. Am I right?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Now
yes.
could you please count at these things? Same. Is there any change?
No.
So our charge is conserved. So that's what we are saying here. The transfer is not the creation of the charge. The transfer is just moving from one object to another object. So one body to another body. So our electric charge is always conserved. You will never remove any electron. So you can shift from one body to another body. So you cannot be able to destroy anything. You cannot be able to create any charges, but you can move the charges from one body to another body. Clear?
Victor?
Yes.
In polarization, the negative charge will be in a side and the positive charge will be in another
yes.
side.
Yes, when you take this amber crystal, you can see here, your amber crystal here is a negatively charged. Now, am I right or not? Because my negative number is yes. more here. Am I right? When yes. you take this negatively charged amber crystal near to this, what will happen? In this amber, for example, so when you place this amber crystal, what will happen? Positive charge will be come and settle one side and negative charge will be go and settle the other side. When you put this crystal near to this, what will happen? Near to this negative, this positive will come and attach. That's what your feather get attached with the amber crystal. Clear?
Yes, thank you.
Same like the balloon concept. I already told you in the last week. Do you remember that? Take the balloon, rub with your head, and then yes. put the balloon near to the wall. What will happen? The balloon will be stick to the wall. Am I right?
Yes, you explained right. that last week. Yeah.
The same concept here. The same concept. When you take the crystal, rub with the hair, it will have positively charge. When you move this positively crystal near to the feather, what will happen? Polarization, charge divisions takes place and it will be attract the another object. Clear?
Yes, it's clear. Thank you.
Okay, that's it. Chapter is over, my dear. So could you please recall the formula? In this chapter, we have three formulas. What are the formulas, my dear? F, which is equal to, that means Coulomb's law. K, magnitude of Q1, magnitude of Q2, divided by R square. What is the value of K? My dear, this is a constant, 8.99 multiply by 10 to the power of 9 a newton meter square over coulombs. Clear?
Coulomb,
my dear. What, my dear?
Coulomb, I think square. No.
Ah, sorry, Coulomb square. Sorry. Okay. Now, my dear, listen carefully. This constant will be given in your paper. So either sometimes we will give 8.99 or sometimes we will give exactly 9. Both are exactly same. Am I right? Am I right or not?
Yes.
Yes, Doctor.
So
yes.
What value is given in your question? Please use that value. If you give the value of K as 8.99, you have to use that value. Suppose if the value of K is given as 9, you have to use the value of K as 9. Clear? Clear, my dear?
Clear, Doctor.
Okay. Yes, what is our second formula? Net charge. Our net charge, which is equal to N multiplied by elementary charge. Am I right? And what is the formula for the current? The formula for the current is charge divided by time. So in this chapter, we are going to use only these three formula. So please, my dear, we are going to work out these five problems today. And out of these five problems, the second problem is very, very important, my dear. Actually, here we have to use some theoretical concept. And the remaining problems are very easy. It's a direct question. Clear?
Yes.
Yes,
clear. Okay. Petra, I can open this one to write because it will be very easy. You cannot be able to see the lines under the writing. Okay, this is our first question. Could you please read what is given in this question? What is the magnitude of the electrostatic force between a singly charged sodium ion? So you have the positive sodium ion. So what is my first charge? My first charge is a positively charged sodium ion, which is nothing but my Q1, which is nothing but my plus E. Am I right?
Yes.
Yes.
And you have another adjacent charged particle, chlorine. So what is the nature of the chlorine ion? It is a negatively charged. So I have to take, this is my second charge. And what is the charge of this chlorine? Negative E. So, and these two charges are separate with a distance. What is the distance, my dear? 2.82 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. Now, by using all these things, what you are going to do, we are going to find what is the electrostatic force. So our electrostatic force is nothing but our Coulomb's law. Am I right? So what is our Coulomb's law, my dear? This has two questions, part A and part B. So first of all, we are going to find the answer for the part A. So we are going to find the electrostatic force. Could you please recall the formula? F, which is equal to K, magnitude of Q1, magnitude of Q2, divided by R square. Am I right?
Yes.
Am I right or not? So what is the value of K? K value is a constant. So I am going to take 9 multiplied by 10 to the power of 9. So if it is 8.99 is given, use that value. Both will give the correct answer. And now you can substitute the value of the charge. What is the value of the charge here? What is the value of the charge here?
Positive.
That means charge value is nothing but, we saw the value, 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb, and this is a constant value. We will give that value. So I have to substitute the value of this Q1, which is nothing but 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. And what is your second charge? Magnitude of the second charge. My dear, what is the magnitude of this negative E?
Positive E.
Positive of E. So again, I have to use the same value, multiply by 10 to the power of minus 19, divided by the value of R is given. So R square, 2.82, multiply by 10 to the power of minus 10, the whole square. When you just work out with your calculator, you will get the answer. And what is the unit for this force, my dear? Newton. Clear?
Clear, yes.
Clear? Okay, our first part of the question is very easy. The most important thing is the second part. Could you please read our second part of the question? The second part of the question is very, very important. What is given in the second part? Again, we are going to calculate the same force, but what you are doing, you are removing one electron from the sodium ion. So that means you remove one electron from the sodium ion. My dear, when you remove one electron from the sodium ion, what will happen? Another positive charge will be coming and sit there. Am I right? You already studied this concept in chemistry. Am I right or not?
Yes, yes.
Yes, because you remove.
So when you remove one electron from the sodium ion, what will happen? That place will be vacant and another positive will come and sit here. So when you remove one electron from the sodium ion, now what is the value of the sodium ion, my dear? The sodium ion has the value of Q1, which is equal to
2E.
2 times of E. Am I right?
Yeah.
And what is your second charge? My second charge is the chlorine and it has the same value as negative E. Clear? So the most important thing, this concept. So they clearly given in the question, if you apply some radiation to remove another electron from the sodium ion, when you remove one electron from the sodium ion, what will happen? Another charge will be coming in that place. So what will happen? So initially I have plus E. When you remove one electron, that space will be a vacant and another one positive E will be come and sit there. So totally positive E plus positive E, which is nothing but 2E. Clear? Clear?
Can you repeat, Doctor?
My dear, you can read the question. You are going to find again the value of the force. You are going to find the value of the force again. But what condition they give? You are removing one electron from the sodium ion. My sodium ion initially, what is the value? What is the value?
A positive.
Positive. Now, when you remove one electron from the sodium ion, what will happen? Positive will be come and sit there. Am I right or not?
Yes.
When you add one electron, negative will come and sit there. Am I right?
Yes.
So here the concept is removing. So what will happen? When you remove one electron, another positive will come and sit. So what is the total of the charge? One. My total of the charge is 2 times of E. Am I right?
Yes, yes. Okay.
So that's what we are using. Now, once you write, again, you have to use the Coulomb's law. What is the Coulomb's law? Again, F which is equal to K Q1 plus Q2 divided by R square. Now you have all the values, but in place of Q1, what you have to do? You have to substitute the value. So K value 9 multiplied by 10 to the power of 9 multiplied by 2 times of E multiplied by minus, but that means magnitude of Q2 is nothing but another E divided by 2.82 multiplied by 10 to the power of 10 the whole square. Now you substitute the value of E. What is the value of E? E is nothing but 1.6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. So when you substitute the value, you will get the answer, and the unit for this force is nothing but newton. Clear?
Doctor,
I have a question.
Yes, my dear.
What will happen if we remove one electron from the chlor? It will be zero
from the
chlor.
Yes, it will be gone.
Oh.
Clear?
Yeah, clear. Thank you.
Okay. So, my dear, it's very easiest question. Just use your chemistry concept. That's it. Understand? Clear?
Yes, clear.
Okay. Let's come for the second question. Yes, my dear.
Doctor.
Yes.
But some students have technical issue, doctor, with the blackboard.
My dear, inshallah, I can't stop the lecture in between. I think the video is recorded. I think they can use later. If they have the issue, I can't solve anything. Okay? Issue. If they have any issue, I can't say anything. But I don't know about the attendance. If they log out, I'm sorry, my dear, I can't do anything.
Doctor, but I have a proof for that.
What?
But I have a proof for that.
Okay, if you have the proof, go and talk with Mr. Bohanine, okay? Because I can't be able to send any email regarding this issue.
I can see the screen, doctor. Just the voice.
What can I do for that? Did you see my PowerPoint? Did you see my PowerPoint?
No. I cannot see the PowerPoint. I send to you on WhatsApp.
Okay, no problem. Listen carefully, and later on you can just open the video and just ask me. I think you are in my lab class, am I right?
Yes, doctor.
I think this is Mr. Abdul Rahman, am I right? By your voice, yes, I recognize you are Abdul Rahman, am I right?
Yes, I am.
Okay, no problem. You come to the lab classes. By the time you can ask if you have any doubt.
Okay, thank you, Doctor.
Okay, my dear, listen carefully. This question is one of the important question, and here some concept, some theoretical concept is hidden behind this. So now you can see I have two charges, positive charge. My charge one has the value of 6 microcoulomb, and my charge two has the value of -2 microcoulomb, and these two charges are separated with the distance L. Understand, my dear? Clear?
Yes.
Okay, and these two charges are exactly sitting on the x-axis, and you have the picture based on x-axis and y-axis, but these two charges are sitting exactly on the x-axis. Now what we are going to do, we are going to take the another charge. We don't know what type of charge, whether it may be positive or negative. Your answer remains the same. If you take the positive charge, you will get the same answer. If you take the negative charge, you will get the same answer. Inshallah, that's what I prepared, these two diagrams. I will tell you one by one. Clear? So now please listen carefully. So, but first of all, I can just draw the picture here. So I am going to draw the first charge. What is my first charge, my dear? Q1. And what is my second charge here? Q2. Am I right? Am I right? And my first charge is positive. My second charge is negative. Am I right? Now, what I'm going to do, I am going to take the third charge. My dear, listen carefully. I'm going to take the third charge, and I'm going to put the third charge in this x-axis. Because first of all, I can write the x-axis and y-axis. So this is my y-axis, this is my x-axis. Now what I am going to do, I am going to put the third charge in this x-axis. When I place the third charge, what you have to do, you have to see the interaction of the first charge on the third, and the second charge on the third must be exactly equal. So when it is equal, it has the value of zero. That means F1 on 3 and F2 on 3 must be equal. If it is must be equal, what is the net electrostatic? It is exactly
Victor.
My dear, you are going to place the third charge in this x-axis. When you place the third charge, interaction must be takes place. Am I right or not?
Your voice, Doctor.
You couldn't hear me?
You can't.
Do you hear me or not?
Log in your voice.
I'm shouting a lot. Still, you are not hearing my voice.
Doctor, you have some yes. problem with your voice.
Do you hear me now? Do you hear me or not?
Yes. But your voice go on back.
Okay. I will shout more, okay? I think now you can hear me. My dear, listen carefully. I'm just drawing the same picture here. Q1, Q2. My Q1 has the value of positive value. My Q2 has the value of negative. Okay. Now what you are going to do? You are going to place the third charge in this x-axis. So you have three locations. What are the three locations? My first location is in the left hand side of the Q1, maybe either here. Clear, my dear?
Doctor, your sound is cutting off, and your screen is not displayed.
What happened to this blackboard?
We can't hear you, Doctor, clearly.
This blackboard has some issue.
Yes, Doctor, all of us.
Teacher, there is a problem in the blackboard.
Doctor, refresh the read.
شنو المشكلة من البلاك بورد؟ كل نفس المشكلة.
الدكتور طلع.